then of course you've got other things in it. And in particular, you could put in a large proton collider, which we call the BAT-LHC, but in my analogy with ESO, we should call it the BLHC, an extremely large proton collider. And the effort is just now starting to develop a physics case for such a process. That's what I wanted to say about the X-ray, and I will return to the symmetry later on. I think it's fair to say that with the continuing overwhelming success of the standard model, there is a sort of countercurrent in the theoretical field system, maybe an epithesis, maybe both, to say, well, you know, maybe there is nothing beyond the standard model. And I would like to caution the community against hubris, and I'm going to drop out a few examples. Michelson, 1894, 3 years before the discovery of the electron. The more important fundamental laws of practical physical science were already discovered. Kelvin, 1900, 5 years before the discovery of the photon, the population of the photon by Einstein. There's nothing new to be discovered in physics now. All that remains is more and more isolated. Our very own, or your very own, Stephen Hawking is the end in sight of theoretical physics. I'm not quite sure what horizon he's working to, but it's over my horizon. So particularly relevant to this discussion of this large circular collider that I was just discussing is another one, which historically is much earlier. So many effective after creations, it's unlikely that anyone could find hitherto physical theories of any value. So I think all of you, all of us who write grant applications are familiar with that sort of report pattern theory. So I don't know whether the sort of future circular colliders that currently we're thinking about will receive the same sort of response from the member states of CERN, that if they do, we'll quote Christopher Columbus again. That's all very well, but actually, is there any evidence at the current time for any physics beyond the standard model? Well, there is. Well, there are pieces of evidence. And one of them is the use of Einstein physics. So a series of experiments that I don't have time to discuss now have shown that the different flavors of neutrino, remember there are three different flavors of neutrino, these three different flavors of neutrino mix and oscillate amongst themselves. I would say the only, but certainly far and away the simplest interpretation of those data is that those neutrinos have different masses. The mass eigenstates are not the same as the weak interaction eigenstates that you produce, for example, in muon decay or beta decay. And under that hypothesis, the mass square differences, I call here delta m squared 2 1 and delta m squared 3 2 have been measured, and the mixing angles, the three mixing angles, have also been measured. By analogy with what you've already seen for the quarks, there should also be a CT violating phase. And one of the interesting results of the past few months, I might actually describe it as the most exciting result of the last few months, or yesterday, was that there is a hint when you've got all the different pieces of neutrino laced together that maybe the CT violating phase is beginning to emerge. And I'll say something about that on the next slide. The point I want to make here is that you cannot accommodate neutrino masses within the standard model, as I wrote down on yesterday, for example. Norwegian high school teacher did it on yesterday, for example. You need additional parameters, three more masses, three more angles, one more phase, seven more parameters. And if you did that, that theory would not actually make calculable sense. If you wanted to make a theory which is actually normalizable, hence calculable, you would actually need, I would say, at least 18 parameters. So almost as many parameters in the neutrino spectra as we already have in the standard model. So I just want to flesh out a little bit the remarks that I made about neutrino mixing, and also just show you this hint from CT values. So the neutrino oscillations are measured in reactor experiments, accelerator experiments, and also using astrophysical neutrinos, solar neutrinos, and also atmospheric neutrinos. And these enable those two mass differences that I mentioned to be measured pretty accurately. And as I showed you, the mixing angles are now also quite well measured. So this is the current information, which is taken from a recent article by Gianluigi Colli and collaborators. And so top left, you see one mass square difference. Top middle, you see another mass square difference. Along the bottom, you see the mixing angles. And top right, you see the CT violating phase. And the vertical axis in this case are the number of standard deviations. So you can see that the likelihood function varies by more than 4 over the range of the CT violating phase data. So this is not a proof of anything, but it is at least interesting that we're getting now into the phase of exploring CT in the neutrino spectrum, which, as I said, is highly beyond the standard model. So let me now talk about another indication for this beyond the standard model, which is provided by the Higgs. Which you may say, well, yesterday and early on this morning, I was at pains to say everything we know about the Higgs system is in the standard model part. So now let's look at the information in a little bit more detail. So you know that fundamental constants, many of them, are not constant. They evolve as a function of the scale at which you measure them. And that's also true of the cortex self-coupling of Higgs orbital lambda. The lambda that's supposed to make the potential go up at large values, if you like, the rim of the Mexican pattern. And that lambda is a normalized by itself, to normalize, and that's what tends to make the thing get bigger still, so that's fine. But there is also a normalization of that cortex coupling lambda by the top quark. That is negative, and proportional to the top quark mass to the fourth power. So, essentially, if you ask this question, that negative normalization could drive the Higgs lambda coupling negative at some scale, and that would actually generate an instability in our current electric vacuum. And here from a paper by DeGraffi et al., you see a calculation of how that Higgs self-coupling lambda goes down as we increase the energy scale. And you get to about 10 to 10, 10 to 30 GeV, the Higgs self-coupling goes negative, and that is a signal of maximum stability. So, as I said, that's 10 to around 10 to 10, 10 to 30 GeV. Well, that instability could be cured if you can't delete the supersymmetry. So I'll come to that in a moment, we'll just continue with this after. So here I have a parameter plane. The horizontal axis is an axis of the boson, the vertical axis is an axis of the top quark. And there's a large green region where the standard model is completely stable. There's a red region where it's slightly unstable. And there's a yellow region where it's less stable. So that means actually the principal unstable after lifetime is longer than the age of the universe. And in the lower on the right hand side, you see where the data currently places, and that is actually probably in the less stable region. Not in the stable region, but in the less stable region. So that means that if you take that standard phase value, all we have to do is wait around 10 to 12 years, and our universe will disappear in a couple of dots. A big crunch, anyway. This is a little picture of what happens. The Mexican hand rim goes up, and then it is brought down by the top quark normalization, and we don't do anything to stop it. labels within the standard model is a provisional one, and it depends on uncertainties in the example setting. It's labs, it's not labs, and anything, it's not labs. This sort of calculation by the Hamster label shows you how the uncertainties in those fundamental constants play into the stability or otherwise of the bracket. The largest uncertainty in this is actually the mass of the top core. I think we now know the mass of the Higgs boson. Reasonably well, copy pattern doesn't matter, that's what we do with the argument, but we would really like to know the mass of the top core better. And you can somehow sort of see this. If you go to that sort of dark core picture on the right-hand side, you have to go a long way to the right to get into the stable region. But you don't have to go very far down, changing the mass of the top core to get into the stable region. So we're hence interested in measuring the top core mass as well as possible. So I've given you a couple of indicators that presumably there is physics beyond the standard model. Machine analysis certainly requires physics beyond the third line of yesterday's jumper. And this instability in the necessary vacuum, if it's confirmed, would also, in my mind, require some physics beyond the standard model. So what else is there? Now I'm going to utter the F word. And I am a believer in supersymmetry, so I've written it in the largest possible font on this slide. There's all sorts of reasons for like supersymmetry, I'll mention some of them in a moment. There's all traditional ones like naturalness, grand unified series, which I'll mention in a moment. If it's plain dark matter, that'd be good. We also, I think, got two additional pieces of experimental support within the last couple of years. One is that supersymmetry correctly predicted the mass of the Higgs boson, predicted that the Higgs boson should weigh below 130 GeV, which it does. And it also predicted, as you saw a few slides back, that the happenings of the Higgs boson should look very much like those in the standard model. So, I mean, we are quite bullish about supersymmetry, of course. But the crunch will come when the energy is increased, and we see that supersymmetric particles come up a bit to do or not. Naturalness is a word that is used a lot, and one could have a whole philosophical debate about how it strongly one should take the argument. But let me just phrase it in the context of the Higgs mass. Here I've written down two one-room diagrams that would normalize the Higgs mass. And those diagrams are, each of them, quantitatively divergent. So there's a contribution coming from the scalars, which is actually just the lower of those two lines, and there's one coming from fermions, which is the other. Now, because of the well-known fact that early on root diagrams have a right in mind, those divergences have opposite sides. And it does not take a rocket scientist or even a field theorist to observe that you could cancel out that leading divergence in the contributions to the Higgs mass if you had this particular relationship between the scalar coupling and the fermion coupling. Where perhaps a field theorist would be useful is to point out that that relationship is exactly what happens in supersymmetry. And a field theorist could also prove to you that that cancellation of those quantitative divergences is something that works not only at the one-group level, but if you calculated 954 loops, it would also cancel. So there's some very strong principle at work, and supersymmetry relates proton masses to fermion masses. Fermion masses are protected by chiral symmetry, and that's what gets rid of the quantitative divergences. So what that means is that you don't have to worry about getting ridiculously large corrections to the Higgs mass square in the supersymmetric theory. You don't have to worry that you might have to adjust the three-level value of the Higgs mass square so that it cancels out against the root correction that you calculate later on, so as to give you 0 to 34 decimal places. Supersymmetry, no problem. Now, there's one other feature of supersymmetry that I would like to mention, and that is electric symmetry rating. So you remember that electric symmetry rating happens in the standard model because you've got a potential which is unstable at the origin. Now, it turns out with supersymmetry, you can actually calculate or predict that negative behavior close to the origin. And if I can come back to our old friend, the top core, in this case, you're happy that it drives that particular parameter negative, and this is a calculation that purports to show that. I don't go through the details of it, but in fact, this enabled some theorists back in the 1980s to predict, way before there were any indications in the traditional electric data, that in order to take the origin of the potential unstable, we would need a relatively large top core mass. Okay, so I've been talking about Higgs bosons and supersymmetry, and I mentioned the fact that supersymmetry actually predicts the mass of the Higgs boson, and it gets it more or less correct. So let me just say a couple of words about that. So, turns out that in supersymmetry, you get what you might describe as double trouble or double the enjoyment. You get two complex Higgs bosons. And then when you remove the degrees of freedom that are eaten, your masses to the W cos minus Z, you've got five cubic copy bosons. The largest of those, at the tree level, weighs less than MZ. So back in the 1980s, experimentalists list the flavoring that they thought at length we're going to be able to make this lighter than MZ Higgs boson. Unfortunately, our old friend, the top cork, put a screw there, and we calculated the quantum corrections for the mass of the Higgs boson in about 1990 and realized that they would actually push the mass of the Higgs boson up, not very far up, as I said, still less than 130 GeV. And this is a calculation of the largest Higgs masses, the red line, the other lines are masses of the other Higgs bosons, and the blue dashed line is the experimental value, and you can see that there's a large range of masses, a large range of parameters, where the Higgs mass is consistent with the LHC measurement. Actually, two regions where it's consistent. There's also a little region over there on the left-hand side that's probably dictated by itself. So this slide justified the remark that I made earlier on that supersymmetry predicted successfully the mass of the Higgs boson. That's all well and good, but of course nobody has seen any trace of supersymmetry. We've only got constraints on it. And I'm a member of a collaboration called Marsico, where we try to take all the present experimental constraints and evaluate their significance for the like, fundamental constants of supersymmetric models. So there's electric precision, what the double thing which I mentioned yesterday, which enabled them previously to take the mass of the top core and the Higgs boson. So they have something to say about supersymmetric particle masses. There's all my favourite physics, which I haven't done justice to. There's the measurement of the Higgs mass. There's dark matter, the density of dark matter and its gravity rate, and of course, such as the ability. So, I mentioned just one experiment that maybe indicates the primitive of the standard model, unless the measurement of the anomalous negative moment of the neutron. I mentioned yesterday that the anomalous negative moment of the electron is a great success for field theory. Not so successful to the anomalous negative moment of the neutron. And there's been some discussions that this might be due to. This discrepancy might be due to supersymmetry or some other low-scale physics, although I think that probably prudent to wait for a new experiment. you. That this sounds very, very hard. Look, it's interesting. And there's lots of lies here across the various different searches and various different programs that can do these things. So, as I said, I'm in a collaboration which tries to put together all this information. This involves communicating between different languages, Fortran, C++, English, German, Italian, etc. If you look at the most general supersymmetric model, it's got way too many parameters. You can't do a sensible analysis. You have to make some sort of judgment about how to simplify those parameters. So, what can you do? So, I've already mentioned the minimal supersymmetric extension of the sign model has two Higgs numbers. This is used over and above the standard model couple of parameters. That's in the supersymmetric limit, but of course, supersymmetry has to be broken, and that's where the additional 100 parameters that I mentioned come in. So, what one convention does in analyzing the data is to make simplified assumptions, and one which I can do on the next couple of slides. Is one in which one assumes that those supersymmetry parameters might have universal, that all the strangers of the supersymmetric partners of the quarks and electrons have the offset of the same mass of normalization, and similarly, the unseen night partners. This is a scan of the CNS part of the brain. Like I said, there's no evidence for supersymmetry anywhere. The green stars represent F8 points, the red lines represent 50% confidence level regions, the blue lines are 95% confidence level regions. And that then enables you to give a likelihood function for, example, here, the squat mass. And we would say, well, it pretty much has to weigh more than 1.5 TeV, if it might weigh 2 TeV, or it might weigh 5 TeV. That's basically all we can say at the time. If it's in that low mass region, then we're in luck, because the LHC will be able to find it. But if it's not in that low mass region, then we're going to have to come back to our future circular collider. This is a similar picture of the mass of the Arduino, roughly, to the centric part of the neuron. And again, so there's a low mass region, which will be acceptable with the LHC, and then there's a high mass region, where we have to go back to our funding agencies and carry it out. That was, if you like, a relatively modest extension of the standard model, at least in terms of energy time. Now we're talking about particles that might weigh only a few TeV. If you want to simplify the gauge structure of the theory, then I think the dominant idea on the market is so-called grand unification. And as is well known, this is based on the fact that the fundamental gauge coupling constants are not constant, they vary. Strong coupling gets weaker, here these are all 1 over the inverses of the coupling tension. So 1 over alpha gets bigger, and you can hope that you might have convergence between the SU3, SU2, and SU1 couplings. As is well known, if you just do that within the standard model, those couplings don't quite meet. But if you do it with supersymmetry at a relatively low scale, then it might meet. And for many people, this is a nice piece of circumstantial hit in favor of both supersymmetry and grand unified theories. So if you just look at this picture here, you think, oh no, this is gee-whiz. But I just wanted to spend one slide saying, well, it's not just gee-whiz. Actually, there is a whole bunch of calculations that go into this. And fortunately, I will show you the formula that works. It's really important, but this has been looked into. They're really quite fancy. So why should we believe any of this stuff? Well, if you have unification of the gauge couplings, then you have a specific prediction for the ratio of what I call the G prime, the U1 coupling, and G2, the S2 coupling. So you would get 3/5 in the limit where G1, G2, G3 all equal. At one loop, you get normalized. So these parameters are 3 here. These are the one loop normalization coefficients. And these are those one loop coefficients without on the left and with supersymmetry on the right. So what you can do is you can take the measured value of sine square theta, the measured value of the electric mixing angle, which I showed you yesterday, which is 0.23, blah, 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 blah. And you can ask yourself, what is the corresponding value of these? Actually, the relevant combination is what I call x there. And x has a value of 1/7 in supersymmetric extension of the standard model, and x has a value of 23 over 218 in standard model. The data, which I put in the measured value of sine square theta, corresponds to x is 1 over 6.92 plus or minus 0.07. So that is, you know, it's not a one by nil check for supersymmetric grand unification, but, you know, it is interesting. So, in a simple grand unified theory, the electronic charge is embedded in a simple group. And because it's embedded, charges quantize. If you look at any representation and you sum up the charges, they have to be equal to zero. I commented yesterday that if you write down the hypercharges in the standard model, they look like a bunch of random numbers, or they're not really random, but, you know, random integers multiplied by 3. It's just, well, those random numbers find a simple interpretation within any grand unified theory, because the fact that the electronic charge is embedded in a simple group, charges quantize. And that mark is independent of the specific grand unified theory that you write down. Simplest one is SU5, and SU5 accommodates in a very simple way the fermions of a single generation, and this is how, for example, you put the fermions of the first generation. Of course, you might wonder how you explain the generation degree of freedom, and the answer, of course, is you don't, as I advertised previously. So flavor is, to my mind, completely unresolved issue. But at least you explain what previously looks like from what random constant numbers to the fundamental fermions. So I talked about the fact that fundamental constants are not the various function of the energy scale. Something is also true for quantum electron matters. You've got your copy data across your electron, and depending on the momentum scale